Hello my friends, welcome again to my video channel and welcome again to this never-ending story. IC201. I've remounted all components, plugged in all connectors, soldered in everything what is needed, and now I want to finalize this project. I assume there are still some faults in it, but I hope it's not so much. First step is to calibrate or to bring this PTO into the standard setting range, which is required. You remember, I fully disassembled the gear. That means the drive is not adjusted, so the setting range of the PTO may not be as specified, and the scale, the drums and so on are not in the right position. So it should be the first step, because when I later check the performance of this transceiver, the frequency indicated should be the right one to check whether the full bandwidth is covered and that I can make an alignment. Just to show you a little bit in detail how this mechanical drive is set. This white plastic gear here can be shifted out a little bit using a screwdriver or similar. And then there's a spring here, you can see it, which holds it in place. And there's a small slot here in which this wheel can move. So it's possible to shift it out here. And when this white wheel here is coming out, then this bronze wheel here, or brass, not bronze, sorry, brass wheel can be rotated in the direction wanted, because on this brass wheel here there is a groove. We cannot see it in the yes, we can see it here. Here's a small pin here which limits the end on both sides. So when the limit is wrong, then it can be changed in the position. This wheel comes out, this can be moved, then the wheel is coming back, and then we can adjust it. Ignore the setting of the scale at this moment, only have a look that the drive itself moves here. This threaded bolt here and the core here of the PTO in the right direction and in the right settings here between maximum and minimum frequency. This is limited here by this pin here. And again, it can be adjusted here by this white wheel, taking it off. And then the next step is, when it is correct mechanically and the correct frequency is measured here, then of course the scale can be adjusted. Both scales, the big one and the small one, will be readjusted so that is exactly in line with the frequency which comes out here. 11.385 is 0 and 12.385 is 1000 kilohertz. So the big and the small one are adjusted for 1000 and 0, and this one is adjusted for 0 and 0 on the big and on the small one. Okay, that's it. It's rather easy. It's good accessible here, and this can be done with a screwdriver, a big one and a small one. The small one is used to move this wheel here a little bit up and down as needed, and the big one here is used to squeeze it out here. Okay, sorry about my hands, but I cannot avoid it that you see it. The goal is 11.385. 411 400, okay, it is not sufficient. I will do it again. It was 200 kilohertz plus minus. We have the difference of, as I see, was 100 kilohertz, so I make 50 kilohertz less, so I go to 11.335. Not 385, that's a little bit too much. 335. 1300 was a little bit too much, I think. And 3.5. A little bit more into my direction here. Okay, I leave it 300. It's 80 kilohertz. Oh, no, it's 80 kilohertz. That's definitely too much. That's okay. 11.35, and I should have 11.38. Now to the upper end, to the high end. Instead of 3.8, I'm 60 kilohertz too high. And so on, and so on, and so on. I think I make it off camera and show you the result. After some tweaking around, the problem is that this mechanical gear cannot be adjusted tooth by tooth. It's a little bit more rough to this due to the pin which is forced into the groove. So it can only be adjusted one round more or one round less, and so on. So the lowest possible frequency is now 11.349 instead of 11.385. So it's roughly 40 kilohertz below. That's okay. And the higher frequency, when I go to the higher frequency here, it's 12.44 instead of 12.38. It's approximately 60 kilohertz. Well, that's okay, in my opinion. I have no problems with it. I will try it a little bit, make it a little bit better, but it's not relevant. I would be happy to have some kilohertz a little bit more down, but as I said, it's only one rotation possible, which comes or comes not. Oh, see, just have an idea here. No, it's not possible. Cannot be adjusted, not a screw. No. Okay. It's good. Now the next step is to adjust the frequency scale here. 11.38 or 12.38. I go to 12.38. This is the upper frequency. This is 1000. I will show it. Hope you can identify it. This is the inner frequency here. It's a smaller ring inside. I can adjust it by hand. 12.385, okay. Counter check when I go down to 11.385, it should be zero. Now it's a little bit difficult to show it on the camera, sorry about it, but 385 should indicate zero. Yes, it is zero. And then we will also adjust the outer ring here to zero. It stands now at the moment at 15. That is good. So the PTO is aligned. Let's go to the upper end to check it. That's it, the PTO is aligned mechanically and electrically. And now some performance checks. First check, FM sensitivity. I'm here at FM mode. Modulated signal, 1 kHz. Frequency with 5 kHz deviation at 145.00 MHz from a signal generator. The output in the moment is 10 microvolt. You hear noise? I go down to 3 microvolts. This is a 3 microvolt signal. We can hear it. And now down to... This is a 1 microvolt signal. As you hear nothing, only noise. At this input voltage, we should have a signal plus noise to noise relation of 30 dB or more. At 1 microvolt should be a very clear signal. We even don't have it at 10 microvolt. So something is rotten here. The attenuator here is of maximum gain. I can show you high, low, high. We are centered here. So this operates here. This is not a problem. Indeed, we have a sensitivity problem. I go to a single sideband. One moment. Still have 10 microvolt. I can hear it. We should have a relation. Let me see sensitivity. Minus 6 dB per microvolt. That means half a microvolt in the moment. We have 10 microvolt input. Same sensitivity. The side tone. No difference. This is 3 microvolt. This is 1 microvolt. Could be barely heard. Again, the attenuator. This is half microvolt, 0.5 microvolt. We should have a signal plus noise to noise ratio of 30 dB or more. I don't need a noise meter. It is not 30 dB. So there is something rotten in the receive path. And I have an idea what it is, but first I will check the transmit output power. The test setup is rather simple. Mode is FM. There is no power limitation. It's always 10 watt. Dummy load. Power meter. I'm in the setting of power forward. Sorry, not yet. Now I'm in powered forward 5 watt range. When I go to transmit here, the pointer doesn't move. It moves a little bit. Let me say some milliwatts or so. But nothing happens here. This is ugly. There is something not okay. It affects both transmitter and receiver. So I think there is one possibility which causes the problem. I will talk about in the next sequence. My first suspect is a buffer amplifier. This one here. This buffer amplifier amplifies the signal from the premixer. That's input here. This wire here comes from the premixer here. And the premixer generates from the
Bernd Kreistl's here and input of the PTO, the premix signal, and there are two outputs. These two outputs are fed to the transmit and to the RX mixer in detail. A little bit bigger here. Okay. It's too big now. That's nice. We have the input from the premixer. The signal has 133.3 to 135.3 megahertz. Or more precise, operating frequency minus 10.7 megahertz. It's the offset because the signal is generated at 10.7 megahertz, FM or CW or SSB signal. This is from the premixer, this frequency here. It is amplified here, and that's the output to the mixer, to the transmit mixer, or to the RX mixer here. And one problem is this integrated circuit here. As I said in one of the previous sequences or videos here, I also have an ICOM IC201, and I had also problems with this integrated circuit here. It failed after some hours of operation. I got it also like this here as a damaged non-working unit. And then suddenly I had also problems here with this integrated circuit here. It's an LM703LH. This IC is hard to get in our days here. It's an amplifier with a plus minus input and output here is a medical output. Or one side is grounded here. Number one SSC is capacitive grounded here and 7 is the output here. This is only bandpass filter for the 133 megahertz signal here to avoid sparry. And this integrated circuit here is a weak point. I will check it. I'm quite sure that it is, but I have to unmount something to get access to it. To get access to the buffer amplifier, we have to unmount the FM unit. I removed the two screws already here. Then we can take out this unit here, this FM unit. And then we can see here the buffer amplifier here. This is the LM703H and the two circuits. Here's the input here, which comes from the premixer. The premixer is here. That's the premixer, the four crystals for the different bands and offsets, relay offsets and so on. And the output here is fed via this contact into this buffer amplifier. And this here is the output here, two outputs which are fed. One is fed to the transmit mixer, which is here, to the pin row here, and the other to the RX unit, which is on the other side here. Well, I will check the voltages here at this unit. I have a feeling that there's something not okay as it should. We can see. And then I have to look for a substitution if it is really the problem. The result of the measurement of the voltages at the pins of the LM703 is indicated a fault in this IC, except the ground connection, which is zero. All other connections are plus 10 volt. The plus 9 volt is nearly plus 10 volt, but that's not the problem because the IC is specified up to 20 volts. This indicates all voltages are high. I've measured it with a high ohmic voltmeter, 10 megohm. All inputs are high. That indicates that the ground connection inside this integrated circuit is interrupted, so it is floating up. But I reject the pin 4 is at ground at zero. So the fault must be inside this IC, this integrated circuit. And now that's a problem. I have looked for it in the net, no chance to get it. LM703LH, it has a round metal case, no chance to get it. There are some offers with a version in a dip line, but I don't dare to buy it. because they are rather or very old, 40 years or so. I'm not sure what I'm getting, so I have another idea. I will tell you later, but I make first a check that it's really this integrated circuit here. I will add a provisional amplifier here. I will take this out here and connect an auxiliary amplifier for laboratory use as an intermediate amplifier with 20 dBs or so, and check whether then this receiver or transceiver works now okay. And then I have to look for a better solution here, and a modern solution. But before I do an external test with an external amplifier here, I will make a simple test. I will feed in here a signal from the external signal generator here, which is 10.7 megahertz below the receive frequency. In the moment, the receiver is tuned to 145 megahertz, and it receives the internal calibrator here. You can see here the movement of the discriminator indication here. I'm going to tune off here, but the signal is very weak. SSB a little bit more, but not so big. Should be much bigger. Next step is I will switch off the internal VFO, go to external VFO here with this knob here. So the internal VFO is switched off, and then I can infeed it here. That's this connection here. There's a small blue wire connected to the buffer amplifier here. There's ground, and this comes from my signal generator. And the signal generator is set to 134.300. 134.300, it's 145 megahertz receive frequency. And you see in FM, we already have a bigger deflection here instead of the internal signal here. SSB is also much bigger here. And the input signal coming from the generator is in a moment, it is set to, I go to 100 millivolts. It's 100 millivolts here. Oh yes. When I set the in-feed power here to 100 millivolt, I don't know what arrives here, because I don't know the impedance of this secondary coil here. But the 100 millivolt is specified when the generator sees here 50 ohms. But I'm not sure whether he sees 50 ohms here. But we have a much bigger deflection. And I will look for transmit power. And now to the transmit test. Mode is FM here. I've connected a small power meter with dummy load. The range is 20 watts forward power. Full scale is 20 watts. Should have 10 watts here specified. Now I will go to transmit here. And then increase slowly the in-feed power here from the 134 megahertz signal generator here, and see what happens. Nothing happens. Okay, something happens here. Now we have approximately, not totally 5 watts. I will turn a little bit to me so that I can see it. Four watts. Okay, it's a little bit too less, I have to increase it here. I go into the range up to 300 millivolts.
Okay, we have 5 watts. You see also in the signal here. Ah, okay. A little bit too much here. It's a SVR power set. Now in the, I'm in the power setting here. Forward power. I have to reduce it a little bit here. It is 5 watts indicated here. I increase it further. 6 watts. Okay. Can't get out more than 6 watts here. Ah, sorry, 10 watts. I mean, the range of 10 watts. A little bit of parallax. It's nearly 10 watts here. FM output. Well, so it's 10 watts. You can see it here. Okay. That is for me a clear indication of the problem. It's the infeed from the premixer, and I'm very sure that the physical problem here, the infeed from the premixer, the problem here is the IC LM703LH. Okay, I will check it with an auxiliary amplifier, laboratory amplifier. I have an idea what I can take. This is, let me give a moment. Here it is. It is a small amplifier here. Such a beast. It's a Hewlett Packard 8447A. It has 50 ohm in and output. It goes from 0.1 to 400 megahertz. I hope it's still working. It's very old here. But I'm quite sure it will work. I will use it as an auxiliary amplifier just for a simple test whether the problem is really here in the IC. But I'm quite sure, so I will use input and output, and the gain is 20 dB. So this should be a good option for a first test, and then we can see. This is a test setup which I had in mind. The output here of the premixer, it's this gray cable here, you can see it, comes out here, soldered to this RG1, what is it, 174 or something like this, to the input of the 50 ohm input of this amplifier, it has 20 dB. The output here goes back to the filter of the buffer amplifier and then into the transceiver. So this amplifier here is exactly connected here between this input here. For your knowledge, we have here, sorry, I've forgotten it. It's a potential free output here. We have here a coil, secondary side of the output transformer of the premixer here. It's potential free, so I can connect it to ground here. The shield is grounded here, of course, via this connector here. And the center is fed to the amplifier here. This capacitor here is, I think, still in place, but it doesn't matter. And the output here is connected the same way. Here we have the shield here, because this is grounded with respect to high frequencies. And this is the output here, coming from the 50 ohms here, and is fed onto the filter here of the buffer amplifier here. Okay, it's switched on here. Everything is switched on. First step is I go to the sorry, I forgot to mention the FM unit. This FM unit is out. It's for reception only, because I need access to the bandpass filter of the buffer amplifier here. So the IF section, which is here, would be not so good if it would be plugged in here. So the FM reception is dead. I can only receive in the moment SSB. But when you... It's a calibrator S9 Plus. It's a big signal here. S9 plus 20 or something like this. Lower sideband and CW. When I take out the CW, I've inserted the plug here. Then I have the side tone here. This also works. Okay. Now to the transmit in FM. I'm going to FM here. The output of the transceiver here is connected to this power meter again, as you have seen it. And now when I go to transmit here, oops, yes, this happens sometimes. It was 10 watt and then we have a shutdown. I think the power supply makes some trouble here. I have to switch it off. There's a current limitation in it, and I think, or I believe, the current is set a little bit too low, or the potentiometer has a bad contact here. Now it is switched on. Hopefully now it helps now. Now we have 10 watts, nearly 10 watts here. We are in the range of 20 watts here, so we have 9 watts or so. So this is a solution here. I need an amplification of 20 dB. It's a 50 ohm technology. Of course, a realignment of the filter here because it's a different impedance than the original IC had. And of course, some realignment of the transmit path and RX path because some of the trimming capacitors may degrade over years, losing contact. Capacity is not okay, so I have to realign it to come to the 10 watt output, not only 8 watts output. The idea I have to replace this amplifier with a so-called MMIC. What's an MMIC? Well, you find a lot of it about in the internet. Small little integrated circuits, three legs, input, output, ground. It's like a transistor, base, emitter, collector. Base is the input, collector is the output. Ground is the emitter. And I need an additional collector resistor to the supply voltage. We have here a 9 or 10 volt supply voltage. Not more. Then we have an amplifier from nearly DC up to some 100 megahertz or gigahertz, depending upon the type. In general, it's at least 1 gigahertz. Low noise, low distortion. These MMICs are used today nearly anywhere in any receiver, transmitter, mixer, metering equipment. You find them everywhere. They are rather cheap. Let me say 50 cent or 1 euro or so per unit. It can be paid. And it is I think it's a solution of nowadays to replace this original IC which we had here, the LM703LH, by this or by such an MMIC as IC. I need only one amplifier to get enough output for the transceiver here. Well, next topic will be, of course, the power supply here, to have a look what's happening there, but that's another topic. And now a quick check of the sensitivity of the receiver. The sensitivity of the IC201 is specified with in SSB mode with 6 dB, minus 6 dB related to 1 microvolt. Minus 6 dB is a quarter of power or half voltage, so it's 0.5 microvolt. When I infeed this signal, 0.5 microvolt, the signal plus noise to noise ratio should be 30 dB or more. Okay. Only noise, no signal. When I switch on the signal here, I can't say whether it's a 30 dB difference or not, but it sounds rather strong here. It's 0.5 microvolt in the input here, assumed.
assumed that the input impedance of this receiver here is 50 ohms because the generator is calibrated for 50 ohms load here. This is a little bit questionable, but I don't have no better ideas. But half a microvolt output, I think it's rather close to the reality here. My question now is whether this amplification here of 20 dB, what we have here, is sufficient or not. I will add some damping here, some attenuation here. I have here some attenuators, for example, 6 dB. Have this signal strength in mind. This is nearly the same here. No big difference. I will choose minus 10 dB. Okay. I don't know the influence on the transmit path, but it indicates me that the 20 dB amplification here, the gain of 20 dB here, is sufficient. Now I have effectively 10 dB because I'm damping it, attenuating it by 10 dB. So plus 20 minus 10 is 10 dB from here to here, plus 10. Okay. That's it. That's my first check. So I can focus now on a MMIC with a 20 dB amplification. And now some words regarding the new circuit. This is the old one here with the LM703LH here. The new version here has here an ERA 3. I've chosen this type because it has a rather high gain, roughly 20 dB, and operates at a rather low voltage here at 3.5 volt DC or so. The series resistor has to be 180 ohms. This 10 microhenry in series here is just to increase a little bit the impedance here. So we have 250 ohms. Otherwise we would have here 50 ohms parallel 180 ohms. I think it also worked, but okay, I did it. This capacitor here can go. The old LM has a differential output here, low and high, so it has to be a floating DC here, so we need here the 10 nanofarad to ground. Here I can operate with no decoupling, so it's possible to ground it here. We have an asymmetrical signal here. It's coupled with 1.5 picofarad here. The output here is rather low ohmic here, so we need a high impedance here in series, a high capacity in series, not to detune this circuit here. It's not a good idea to directly connect 50 ohms in parallel to the circuit here. The old LM703 had an output conductance here of 0.03 millimo. For those who don't know what is millimo or mo, mo is a conductance, it's ohm reversed, that's mo. Normally the unit is Siemens, but in some regions of the world the name Siemens is not spoken, so they decided mo. Anyhow, nowadays it's Siemens. 0.03 millimo, 1 millimo is kilo ohm. And 0.03 millimo is 33 kilo ohms. So the output here is 33 kilo ohms. So this can be connected in parallel to the circuit here without detuning it, but not 50 ohms. So I added here in series 1.5 picofarad. Okay, some capacity to ground here for decoupling. This cable, which was here also potential free because the input also had high and low, it had to be decoupled from ground regarding DC. Here it is grounded because I also have a non-symmetrical input here, 50 ohms, but it doesn't matter. The output here is rather low ohmic here. It's the secondary side of a small transformer. Okay, that's the circuit, and I will show you the realization. That's the realization. On the bottom layer here, I added here a small PC and scratched some islands here of copper into this copper shielded or copper foiled circuit board here. Here is this little black spot here. You nearly can see it here. Besides this yellow cap here, this little black spot here is the MMIC. Output coupling 1.5 picofarad, input coupling. This is input from the premixer power supply here, 9 volt. This is a resistor, and here is a choke. So this little circuit here is a complete circuit for the, you can see it here again from the side a little bit better here. This is a circuit here of the amplification, two filters in the output here. I will install it now to this flaps here, as it should be, and then install the FM unit, and we can make some tests. And now some sensitivity checks. Mode is FM. In-feed is a signal with 1 kHz modulation frequency and 5 kHz deviation. No S-meter indication, of course, it's a very weak signal, but it's a rather clear signal here. There's noise. You can also see the discriminator here. The lamp here is not okay, I have to exchange it. When I increase the voltage here by 10 dB and so on, then we will see the S-meter is reacting. I switch the modulation off, go to SSB, upper sideband here. Here's a S-meter deflection, lower sideband CW. Frequency is nearly zero here. The linearity of the PTO is very good. We have here zero, nearly the zero position here at 145, but it is zero. I switch on the calibrator here and switch off the external signal generator. So we have a strong signal here, 500 kilohertz more. When it comes to zero here, okay, we have 1 kHz more. The green scale here, the upper scale, is 1 kHz per division. That's okay. There are some birdies. Ignore them. Okay. Roughly 2 kHz. This is a lever for the fine tuning here. Fast tuning. Okay, the linearity is rather good here. I think an error of 1 or 2 kHz over the whole range is acceptable. It can be adjusted in the PTO, but I don't do it in the moment. Well, let's check the output. First, I will measure the output in FM here, setting FM, no microphone, no modulation, only the carrier. I hope the power supply doesn't switch off again. It's always a little bit a Russian roulette here, whether it switches off. Don't know what's going on there. Full scale output is 20 watts here. Power is forward. Then I switch on it. Maybe it happened. You have seen it. I have to switch it off. There was full output, and then the power supply switched off. I have to wait some seconds. Just show it to you to see that we have still a problem here. Okay, 8 or 9 watts, full scale is 20 watts, that's okay. SSB, I will take a microphone, but in the moment I have no microphone here at hand. I have to look for it, for some microphone. Maybe I will find one. Okay, don't have a microphone at hand in the moment, I have it in my shack. I will take out the power supply, check what happens there. I estimate the overcurrent protection is switching off a little bit too early. There's a trim pot. But I have also found another problem here. The Christel oscillator doesn't work. I will show it. When I go to FM, we can't hear it. I'll try to transmit again. It shut off, but you saw it, there was power. Then I go to the one of the crystals here. When I go to transmit, nothing happens. A, B, C, D, no output. B, C, D, B, A. When I go back to VFO here, sorry, you can see it. In A, B, C, D, no output power. And when I go back to VFO here, again, power. And switched off again, as I see. Okay. Crystals don't operate, power supply has to be checked. There is something wrong, I assume, with the overcurrent protection.